Hello. Hello.
Hello, Ben. Hello, Alberto. Welcome everyone to our French Grand Prix broadcast here at the circuit of Paul Ricard. And once again with me, I have Alberto Ibanez. Hello, Alberto. How is everything today?
Hello, everything's fine. We're looking at many new drivers and new cars today. Again, a great, great grid, 28 cars on the grid. So I think we're looking forward to a very interesting race here.
So I will ask our director, Ben, to show us the lap around Paul Ricard, please.
Niki Lauda hat hier schon einmal gewonnen, das war 1975 mit einem Ferrari. Schauen wir uns aber jetzt eine Runde aus der Sicht des Fahrers an. Am Steuer sitzt der Franzose Jean-Pierre Jabouille und er fährt, das wissen Sie ja, den Renault Turbo. Der Kurs von Le Castellet ist 5,81 Kilometer lang. Das ist die Links-Rechts-Kombination, die absolut voll im fünften Gang gefahren wird. Hier hatte Mario Andretti vorgestern im Training einen schweren Unfall, bei dem er aber unverletzt geblieben ist. Diese Schikane heruntergeschaltet in den zweiten Gang, Kurve Le Col. Das ist diese Rechtskurve, immer noch zweiter Gang. Saint-Baume, dritter Gang. Vierter Gang. Und das ist die wichtigste Kurve wahrscheinlich der gesamten Rennstrecke, denn sie bestimmt darüber, wie schnell der Fahrer auf die lange Gerade kommt. Und diese Mistral-Gerade, in der sich Jean-Pierre Jabouille momentan befindet, misst 1,8 Kilometer. Das ist das längste Geradeausstück im gesamten Grand Prix-Geschehen. Keine andere Rennstrecke hat eine derart lange Gerade. Und hier können Sie ermessen, wie uneben diese Gerade ist und welche Belastung die Radaufhängungen aushalten müssen. Bremspunkt 100 Meter, vierter Gang für die Rechtskurve von Sinn. Dritter Gang für die Rechtskurve von BOC. Eine sehr lange Kurve, von der man glaubt, dass sie nie aufhören wird. Ähnlich wie die Karussellkurve, die Sie vor 15 Tagen beim Grand Prix von Schweden in Andersdorp gesehen haben. Das ist das Kurvengeschlenk im Innenteil der Pinsel, also die Haarnadel. Zweiter Gang, vierter Gang. Hier hatte Claire Gazzoni vor 2 Jahren einen Unfall, weil sein Motor blockiert hat. Und das ist die Kurve von Pont, die zurückfährt auf die Start-Zielgerade. Eine Runde, 5,81 Kilometer. Schaltmanöver 12 Mal pro Runde und wir haben.
And we are back live. So this was a lap around the historic Paul Ricard circuit, the longer version. And I guess it's a very fast track, Alberto. What do you think of it?
Oh, yes, it is. It's one of those tracks that has, again, like not many today nowadays, that has a big personality. And I think everyone, the first thing that can look at when seeing a map of Paul Ricard is that big straight, the Mistral straight. That's one of the places where the Formula Ones and many other cars have been able to reach some incredible top speeds, and where we have seen some very peculiar things, like sometimes at the beginning of the 80s, Porsche's 935 even being able to overtake Formula One cars there. It's a very big straight. It's something that will no doubt favor the most powerful cars, like the Ferrari, the Ligier, and all those that have those big V12s. But then again, the track is a very different section with many tight turns that will immediately compensate for the other cars. So yeah, it's a very interesting track where we will see very mixed action all around the lap.
Indeed, I remember one of my first references for me at this track was in some Michel Vaillant book, where Michel Vaillant was saying in the comic that it was a very safe track. And indeed, looking at it, we can see, you know, big runoff areas, which was very uncommon in the 70s.
Yeah, that's true. The tracks in the 70s were not exactly known for being too safe. We all remember the big campaign that Sir Jackie Stewart did for many years, trying to improve the safety of the tracks. This all started giving its fruits in the 70s, and then later, especially in the 80s. But back then, in 1978, certainly Paul Ricard was one of the safest ones.
And meanwhile, before this warm-up ends, and it's almost ending, we will show you the championship standings, where now, of course, Greg Wasson is our leader. And he's promising to extend that lead here today, because once again, he will start from pole.
But not surprising in the case of Greg, because his driving ability is for sure able to overcome any shortcomings in the car. But then again, the Shadow, the DN9 that they are driving now, is certainly also a decent car, good enough to be able to be put on the pole. But then if you see the lap times in the warm-up, you see that Yves Placet, who is one of the histories that we will be looking at today, has also placed his car, his Ligier, in third place. Yves has just got the Ligier coming from another car, and it's a very nice combination for today, because it's a French car, a French driver, and a French track. So again, like I said, one of the histories of today.
Yes, more on that in the meantime. We will get to that. In the Constructors' Championship, I guess if Vincent can overcome his problems with disconnectings, and he had quite a few in this season, unfortunately, maybe Shadow will be also looking good for the championship in the long run, because for Lotus, only Gerard seems to be able to rack up points consistently, and nobody else has been consistent enough at the front. So it's looking good for the Shadow team overall.
Well, it sure is, because they have two top drivers, and like you said, if there are no disco problems for them, then for sure they will be scoring some points.
So like I said, warm-up is over, and we should be moving to our race here soon. And indeed, Greg Wasson and the Shadow team are looking good to increase their advantage here. I don't think the championship will run away from the Shadow team at this point. They have already a seizable advantage. And with Greg and Vincent at the helm, I think it will be very hard for anyone to catch the team in the point standings.
Well, most probably it will, but you know, there are always surprises in Formula One.
And speaking of surprises, we have many new drivers here. Who knows? Maybe we can find our next talent here today. So now we're moving to the race session. So soon the drivers will be lining up at the grid. And they are indeed. Now, this is a long track. So fortunately for me, I will be able to run down all the grid for you today. We have 28 cars here in this grid. And again, a very nice grid size for us, and promising a very good race for everyone at home. We have some new faces here. We will get that in a while too. And as we see the cars lining up, front row domination from the Shadow team. How they wish that would happen in real life back then, I'm sure. And we have some new faces also in competitive cars. For example, Dan Assurer is in third in the privateer Rabac Lotus.
Yes, Dan Assurer is one of the new drivers that will be changing cars today together with Yves Placet. And I don't think that we will be saying anything new if we say that she's a great driver. And now that she has a car that has the ability to let her shine, she certainly hasn't disappointed, and there she is at third place.
Yes, so running from the top, Grégoire Guassin is on pole. Vincent Beretta is second on the grid. Dan Assurer with the Rabac Lotus is third. Gerard Brion in the Works Team Lotus is fourth with Lotus 79. It is Jan Kowalski in the Tyrrell. Sixth, Ray Ridal, a great performance from him in the Cooper Sucker. Seventh is Mick Chapman in the Arrows. Eighth, Philippe Martinelli, his teammate in the other Arrows. Nine is Didier Conjured with the other Lotus 79. And David Jacques in the other Tyrrell. 11th, Petr Lavak in the Williams. 12th, Yves Placet in the Ligier now. 13th, Jan Tietze driving the Wolf. 14th, Matthias Weber in the McLaren. 15th, Martin Lassina in the Ensign. 16th Michał Janak in the Surtees, 17th François Hemen in the Ferrari, 18th Jason White with the Brabham, 19th Pascal Lepeve in the McLaren, 20th is Raul Jarev in the other Brabham, 21st we have Miroslav Lavic in the Surtees, 22nd Emmanuel Haas in the ATS now, 23rd Mike Becknell in the Martini, 24th it's Jonathan Asserklint in the McLaren M26, 25th David Sabre in the other ATS, 26th Florken Mark or Mark Florken in the other Ferrari, 27th Simon Wattman with the powerful Renault car, and 28th a new starter here today, Matt Geddes in the Berzario. So looking at this grid, Alberto, we have two new drivers, at least two different drivers aboard the ATS machines. Both drivers could make it here today. And we have Yves Passet indeed in the Ligier and Dana Schurer with the Lotus. So a lot of things to grab our attention here today.
Yes, certainly. Many stories, many new drivers who have changed the ride, and even also a newcomer, this is Matt Geddes, a guy who has registered today and has been allowed to take part in this Formula One Grand Prix. So from here, we say to him, welcome and enjoy the race. And like you said, Richard, let's see if we discover some new talent here. Lining up for the grid now.
Exactly. The drivers are lining up for the grid. Tense moments as always. Let's see if everything goes according to plan and who can get the whole shot. Still a long way to the first corner here, which is a very, very fast left-right complex.
Tense moments for sure.
Red lights coming out. And they're off. The race started. Greg Wasson spins his tires and someone shoots up the inside. It's Jan Kowalski. Jan Kowalski overtaking Vincent Perretta right away and trying to do the same with Greg, but Greg covers it and he's in the lead. Although his engine seems to be smoking just a little bit. Maybe it just got a bit too hot there at the start.
Yes, certainly. Some car seems to be smoking.
Ooh, Jan Kowalski, he missed the breaking point. He's on the dirt, but he's back on track.
He had a lot of luck. Those cold tires are very, very, very treacherous.
Oh, we have some drama at the back. We have already a retirement. Mike Becknell has lost a wheel, and I don't think he can recover from that.
Oh, it's a shame, that was fast.
Indeed. And well, excluding that, I think everyone is still in this race. And Jan Kowalski has just taken the lead. Jan Kowalski overtook Greg Wasser down the long straight of Mistral. We will see a lot of overtaking there. So Jan Kowalski leads this French Grand Prix. Ooh, but Greg is fighting back immediately. He's on the inside now, and he's through.
Well, you can't make any kind of error in front of Greg. We all know about his quality, and this is something is also for certain. The ability of the arrows to stick in those long, high-speed turns, because it's a ground effect car, must also have played a role here.
Yes, Jan Kowalski having a lot of trouble putting the power down, unlike the Shadow Voice, but still, it was a great, great effort from him. Just like saying to Greg, hey, you know, you have to deal with me in the F5000 races, and maybe you have to deal with me here too.
Yeah, he's certainly making his point. He's letting Greg know that he's there.
So first lap completed, and we have Greg Wasson, Jan Kowalski, and Vincent Beretta. Vincent now attacking Jan there. Let's see if Jan Kowalski can sustain the attacks of Vincent. It's the fight for the second place now. And behind him, Gerard Rion, as always, cool, calm, and collected, and watching all the action. Ooh, I'm sorry. I mean, Dana Schurer, and Gerard is right behind her. So these boys cannot afford to make a mistake, or else they will fall into the clutches of the Lotus people.
Well, in the case of Dana Schurer, I can tell you she might be fast, but overall she's a very, very regular driver. So for certain, she will be the one to put a lot of pressure on the guys who are in front, because everybody knows here that she will not make errors easily.
Jan Kowalski now under pressure from Vincent. He's looking down on the inside, but that Tyrrell is very fast down the straight. But still, ooh, they touch wheels there. but Vincent is through. So Vincent is now second place, making it 1-2 for the shadow team. And Jan Kowalski dropped back to third. So let's see if he can keep up, or if it's going to be a runaway race for the shadow team.
I guess in this first lap, they both are trying to determine who of them is able to go quicker, because those are both very calculating drivers. So they probably will try to see which one has the best chances of leading to build a gap with the rest of the cars. And then once they are happy with the rhythm, they might start the hostilities among them.
Yes, Jan Kowalski very close to Vincent there. He indeed doesn't seem to want him to get away. Meanwhile, behind them, Gerard Rion has disposed from Dan Assurer and is now the fourth place man on the track. Dan is demoted to fifth, while Ray Vidal is rounding up the top six in a very good performance with a Cooper Sucker there.
Yes, again, Ray Vidal, a guy who had been somehow more disappeared in the last races. We were wondering what was happening, probably tracks that were not exactly favoring that Cooper Sucker. But again, Ray Vidal is a guy who is always a regular there in the top 10. So somehow we're back to normal here, watching him there standing, stalking the cars in front and waiting for any opportunity.
Oh yes, an opportunity might come his way now, because Ray Vidal is very close to Dan Assurer. Ray Vidal and Dan Assurer are fighting for the fifth place now. And down the long straight, Ray is getting closer and closer. And he's looking on the inside now. A lot of sparks coming from his car, but he wasn't able to go through, so he has to stay behind her for the moment. But he's looking very menacing there.
Yeah, meanwhile, Gerard Rion had an outing of the track, but it doesn't seem to have hurt his position. He has been able to keep it on the track. No, I wanted to say also that Dan Assurer has also a Lotus 79 right now, but it is the Rebac, which is a car that has not as good engine as the one in the official team Lotus. And I'm not sure, but probably also either doesn't have the same good engine as the Cooper Sucker. The Rebac has a very good chassis, but it's probably also one of the poorest engines on the grid. So, again, quite good, but Dan has been able to do with it, since we're standing the pressure from Vidal certainly very well.
Well, actually, I think Dan is still driving the old 78 model, although the rear wing seems the 79 one, at least to me. But, well, it's a more competitive car, at least to her, than the old Ligier. The old Ligier, by the way, is not doing bad at all, because he's in 8th place, with Yves Passé at the helm.
I stand corrected. Looking at the list, certainly Dan is still driving a Lotus 78. You're right.
Oops. Mick Chapman there on the dirt, trying to get back to the track now, which is sometimes a harder task than we might think, with so much power going to the back wheels only. But he's making his way to the track now, and there he goes again.
Meanwhile, Joe seems to have had an accident and is out with suspension damage. And Simon Wattman has lost the front wing and is heading for the pits now, a lap down.
Maybe there's a relation there. Meanwhile, an incredible battle, it seems. It's between Philippe Martinelli, Matthias Weber, and François Remen at the moment, a battle for the 10th place on the track. And they sure are close to each other. But let's focus now on Gerard Rion, because Gerard Rion was overtaken again by Dan Assurer and is now under attack from Ray Vidal.
Yeah, it seems that he is suffering for some kind of lack of concentration at the beginning of the race. He has had some outing, and I would guess that he is somehow not happy with the setup of his car. He's not finding the correct points for the turn entry or the braking. That's hurting him.
Ooh, very slippery there. His back stepping out from him.
One must also recognize that because there are going to be no stops for fuel during the race, It's also something very important that these cars must be set up for the total conditions they're going to experiment. So it may very well happen that the car is not great at the beginning of the race, but as the tank goes empty, it starts becoming safer and somehow gives you more confidence.
Well, indeed, let's see how that evolves. What is evolving as usual, apparently, is Grégoire Guassin's lead, because he's now 5 seconds ahead of his teammates. And I guess it will be a typical Greg affair here today, if nobody can stop him.
I guess we will have to start calling him Greg Vettel, because he's doing the same tactics, or Greg Reining, if we're looking at the golden era of motorcycling.
Well, I would say I would compare that to, more to Mick Doohan in his lonely wins in the mid 90s, but it's still a fair comparison with any, you know, any big talent of motor racing. In the meantime, Vincent Peretta seems to have just enough to stay ahead of Jan Kowalski. He's not getting away from him, but he's also directly under attack from him. And behind him, Dana Shore is trying to consolidate her fourth place now, while Gerard Rion behind her once again got just a little bit off course, but without losing much time. But Ray Vidal is always there putting the pressure on him.
Well, yes, he is. We already mentioned that. Ray is a guy that will never give up. He's always there stalking. He's never doing over-aggressive movements, but he's always letting you know that he's there right behind you, waiting for any opportunity. And in the end, after some laps, that certainly begins to get on your mind.
Yes, because right behind Gerard he is now, once again getting very close to that Lotus in the long straight, and Gerard once again going too wide. He went on the dirt, but he recovered, fortunately for him. But he can't afford to do that very often, because there will be a time where he won't be able to catch his car anymore.
We could look a bit now to Yves Placé, one of our stories today, because he's also putting some pressure on David Jacques.
Indeed,
he's making very good use of that big V12 that is in his Ligier. And I think that if we follow him a bit for the lap, we will find that when they arrive at the Mistral Strait, that V12 will certainly be making its point.
Indeed, Yves, he wasn't comfortable with the ensign for a long time. He saw the opportunity to jump into the French team, and he didn't look back. Ooh, he got a little bit off course there. I guess the Tyrrell works a lot better than the Ligier here during these corners, and he was overtaken by Jan Tietz now.
Yes, that's what we were talking about at the beginning. For similar lap times, there are cars like the Ligier that would completely achieve it thanks to their engine power in the quickest part of the track, and then the other cars will do it with grip on the slow parts of the track. So the challenge here, if you're driving a quick car, as is the case of Yves Placé, is to be able to just to stay focused and to know the limitations of your car when you are on the slow part of the track, because it's so easy to try to follow another quicker car with the same rhythm through those turns and then go out, as has happened to him.
Ooh, Tietz taking defensive man. Yes, Tietz taking a defensive line there, because Yves was getting really, really close on the power, like you said, and he was going to overtake him. And now we're back to a more twisty part of the track, where the ground effects of Jan Tietz allow him to just get a little bit away from Yves and onto the back of David Jacques there. But still, I don't think Yves will be sitting there for long, because he's for sure trying to not lose as much time as possible here.
Yes, I think for Yves it's a matter of doing enough laps to get really adapted to the strengths of the Ligier, and then we will see how he is able to follow them much better through that twisty section. But he has to adapt to a very different mindset, because the car he was driving before was a car you had to gain everything on the corners, because it was not a powerful car. But then with the Ligier, it's quite the opposite. Everything in this car is being able to come out of the turns with enough traction to be able to make the most of the elapsed time on the straights.
Yes, and let's not forget that Yves is probably driving a very heavy car, because the Matter V12 is very thirsty on fuel, and he needs much more fuel than, well, the rest of them to be able to complete the race. So they are on the long straight once again. Let's see if Yves can make up any ground.
Well, he certainly catches them very fast. You can see that, how the gap is closing. But the problem for Yves is that, incredibly, that straight is not long enough.
It seems so. Jan Tietz was profiting from the draft of the Tyrol, which is also a very fast car down the straight. So he manages to just stay out of reach from Yves Boisset there, although he cannot or could not overtake Davy Jakes there also. Still, he's trying now. He's trying different lines there, trying to get away or manage to find a way past the Canadian driver. And he's sure it seems that David Jakes is holding up Jan Tietz a bit at this point.
Yeah, if that's the case, this could work certainly in favor of Phipps, because if they are hampering each other, then all that will be an opportunity for Ibs to catch up.
Meanwhile, we have the confirmed retirements of Didier Conjou in the Lotus 79 and Simon Wattman, our lonely Renault here today, with a confirmed retirement too. So that's a shame. They both joined Mike Becknell in the retirees of this race so far. And behind Yves, we can see he seems to be getting a bit closer, is Philippe Martinelli.
Yes, Philippe is another of our very constant drivers. And as long as the guys in front are fighting it out, all that will just give Philippe, who is very steady in his rhythm normally, more chances to get closer.
Yes, and the closer he will, the Arrows is a very competitive car, and I don't think we've seen some races back to front from him in the past, and I wouldn't be surprised if he does the same here today. Meanwhile, Jan Tietz was able to overtake Davy Jakes finally, and now it's Yves' turn to put the pressure again on the Tyrol driver. He seems to have a lot of trouble keeping the car between the white lines here.
Yes, that part of the track is certainly not favoring such a heavy car. And Yves is also pushing it quite widely to be able to make contact with David Jakes, because he has seen already the effect of the pressure on David by Jan. And he, well, obviously wants to profit for the same thing. And he hopes to catch David in a moment where his state of mind is not the best after being overtaken. But these turns here, these quick turns, are what the Ligier is really hurt, because it is not a ground effects car. Oh, there you get it.
Mistake there, and there goes the
yes. It paid off in the end. Well, like I was saying, those fast turns are no good for the Ligier, because it's a very heavy car, so it has lots of inertia. And that's a point where you need to change direction very quickly. So, well, that's a point where the Ligier is suffering more. Now let's see what happens.
Is David can follow Yves there. He's using the draft to try to do it. And he's very close now.
Yes, but you can see that he's completely unable to go out of the draft and have any hope of overtaking. Because he realizes that the Ligier is a much more powerful car. So as soon as he comes out of the draft, doesn't have any ability to overtake. He knows he must do it in the twisted section, but then he will discover something else about the Ligier. Not only is it a heavy car, it's also a very big car. It's quite wide. It's not going to be easy, because it doesn't leave much room at its size to overtake.
It appears so, and indeed, actually, David Jakes is now under attack from Philippe Martinelli.
Yes, like we were saying, Philippe has not lost the opportunity to get closer, and he's putting now some pressure on David Jakes.
David Jakes, who came out of that last corner very, very well, now regained space once again, but the arrows is, with its ground effects, is working very well there on that fast section. And Philippe Martinelli is able to close right up again against David there.
Philippe is anyway also a very patient guy. He can be there as long as needed without getting nervous, waiting for his opportunity.
Ooh, and he's working for it. Now let's see on the straight, which is probably the weakest point of the arrows here. Both the Tyrrell and the Ligier are very fast down this straight. But
yes, probably David's hopes are to be able to make a bit of a gap at that point, so that Philippe can be that close when they enter the twisty section of the track, because as you pointed out, the arrows is certainly a much quicker car there. There you have it, getting much closer now. Well, David is struggling with the Tyrrell.
It's visible, struggling too much. That was a
and
bit
there you have
too
it.
Wide there, and
classic
now he lost the
Philippe
position.
Martinelli pass. He was there waiting for the opportunity, and he didn't miss it at all. He was completely ready when it happened.
So Philippe Martinelli now goes up to ninth place, while David Jakes is demoted to 10th. And still, let's see if Philippe Martinelli can catch Yves Placé.
Well, I guess Yves will be a very hard bone to chew, because he's not that prone to making errors. And he has a very powerful car. So we have here an interesting confrontation, a car that is very good on the twisty section and a car that is very good on the fast section of the track. We will see which is the one that will persevere.
Indeed, Philippe Martinelli getting closer here, as expected. We shall see down the straight if Philippe Martinelli can get to the draft or keep up, or if he will be left in the dust. He's trying to follow the draft now, but Yves is just pulling away at this point. There's no chance there. But now let's see as they enter these fast corners here where Philippe Martinelli is very, very strong. And he's closing right up again. Like you said, Yves Placé is not a man prone to make mistakes. So it probably will prove a little harder to overtake him there than it was to overtake David there. Yves covering the line. Philippe Martinelli is right up his back. Coming to the penultimate corner here, which is a long left-hander. Philippe Martinelli tries here to look on the inside, but Yves Placé leaves him no room.
Yves knew very well which was the next corner, and he had it covered.
Indeed, and that's the
he
end of
an
another
old
lap.
Fox. It's not going to be easy to overtake him.
But Philippe Martinelli can maybe try something here. His car is much faster here at this section of the track.
Yes, but these quick corners are also not a place to overtake. It's maddening because you see that you are much quicker, but then again, you have no gap to go inside.
Indeed, Yves keeping the car on the track, keeping everything at hand, and he's still ahead.
Yves knows well enough that those slow corners are one of his weak points. The traction of the Matra coming out of them is not the best. So he will ensure that he takes those corners sideways, making the most of them and not leaving enough room.
Once again, down the long straight.
He's now approaching Mark Florking. And he will probably, you know, in Yves, try to time it in a way that he leaves Mark between him and Philippe in the parts of the track that are more difficult for the Ligier.
Indeed, Mark Fölking losing a lap here already. We shall see if he lets them both through. Ooh, Philippe is very, very close now. He was looking there on the outside, but no room there. And Mark...
There you have it. I told you. That's exactly what Yves was going to do. I knew it. He was going to make a pass in a point where he was sure that the lap car would be a hindrance for the one who is following him.
Well, it was very unfortunate.
I don't think that Mark was to blame here. But Felipe didn't want to miss the opportunity, and Mark probably didn't count with the second car going in at that point.
Yes, I guess he didn't see him, because Felipe tried to go straight away behind Yves, and it proved to be a risky move. And now Felipe Martinelli has to do it all over again to catch Yves, and this assuming that he doesn't have any substantial damage.
Well, that you see it, like we say in Spain, that, well, being a veteran is a degree, and being so experienced as Philippe is, as Yves is 2 degrees. So one thing is experience, another is being a veteran.
Yes, still, Philippe Martinelli was able to catch Yves right up again in the twisty section, but once again, he's feeling, in a very badly way, the power of the Matra V12, as he sees Yves once again pull away down the long straight. As they are approaching now, Matt Geddes, a new face here today. He's driving the Merzario. And well, he's not doing bad for himself. He's still in this race, keeping out of trouble. Let's see if he moves aside. Yves closing there. Oh, he moves aside well indeed, to the point of going off track. I don't think that all of that is necessary, but well done there. And Philippe Martinelli is once again looking around Yves, trying to find a way past, but Yves, once again, in very Yves style, is covering all holes, covering every inch of the track. And once again, Philippe Martinelli has to stay behind.
Well, this is a very interesting battle. Philippe is now trying to make his move.
Who he is? And I guess he might get through here. He's already ahead. Ooh, Yves just shuts the door there at the last minute. He was able to just pull a little bit ahead with the power of the V12. And he's still ahead.
I was going to say that this is a very interesting battle. And it's making us miss some other interesting battles that are on the track now. I will just report about it. It's François Remain, Matthias Weber, and Peter Lavac. Those three are also fighting at some points, even 3 wide between them for 10th, 11th, and 12th place. For 11th, 12th, and 13th place.
Indeed, all the action is. We would need several cameras here to follow all the action, but now Philippe Martinelli is very, very close to Yves, to the point where Yves had to move on the inside to try to break the draft from Philippe there. But now Philippe is trying on the inside now, using all the grip that the arrows provides him. Ooh, Yves is resisting on the outside.
And look at that, that's precision driving.
Oh, they almost touched.
They were just centimeters apart.
Indeed, a very, very good maneuver there. Yves resisted as long as he could, but Philippe Martinelli was always going to go through there, and he did. So now Philippe is in front, and he will want to put as much space as he can between him and Yves before they get to the long straight, or else Yves might have a chance to overtake him again.
Well, meanwhile, David Jax is also not losing that train of cars, and he's certainly, again, trying to put pressure on Yves. This will probably also be a problem for Yves, because if he has to defend his position, that will make for him much harder to be able to stay with Philippe Martinelli.
Yes, it seems that Philippe was able to pull a gap already, and now Yves seems to be in trouble from David there, who I guess got the time to cool off a bit, and he's now attacking Yves once again. Still, it won't be easy to overtake him. He doesn't have the grip advantage that Philippe has, so I guess it will be a more evenly matched here.
Well, Yves' biggest hopes are, of course, here in the Mistral Strait. So, unless he can get a good run there, well.
David is alongside now. He's not totally
but
through,
look at
but
that
he's almost.
Power. He was again overtaking.
He
Amazing.
Was, yes. And David went too wide, too far to stay ahead of Yves. He ran off track, and Yves is through once again.
You can just see how Yves did the absolute perfect maneuver. He just braked at the perfect point, 1 meter ahead of that, and you were out. And that's exactly what happens to David Jax. That single meter that he missed his braking points in his quest to be able to make his position last, that's exactly what brought him out.
Well, they don't seem to be able to get away from each other here, and maybe this battle will last almost all race long.
Well, that would be certainly stressing for the drivers.
So rounding up the top 10 at the moment, now that we have almost a third of this race completed, 16 laps of 54, have Greg Rogoisin leading, Vincent Perret is in second, Jan Kowalski is third, Dana Schurer is fourth, Gerard Mignon is now in fifth, Ray Riddall is still holding sixth place there, Jan Tietz is seventh, Philippe Martinelli is now eighth, Yves Passé is ninth, and David Jacques is rounding up the top 10.
And right behind them are the guys we are seeing now on screen, I believe. That's Matthias Weber and François Ramin, who are fighting it out for 12th position. And François has already been for some time putting some pressure on Matthias Weber. And here is what would be a classical picture from another season. The McLaren, the white and red McLaren against the Ferrari.
Indeed, who doesn't remember the fights between James Hunt and Niki Lauda? Although here, in this season, it would be more between, in this case, I believe, that's not James Hunt, it's... who was driving with James Hunt? My memory fails here.
David
I'm
Watson,
not that old.
Was it? James Watson, sorry.
Yes, I think it was already James Watson. And François Remen is, of course, driving the number 11 Ferrari. And he's trying to get as close as he can to Matthias there. And he seems to be able to in this more twisty section, which is a surprise, because we would all assume that the Ferrari power would enable him to just get behind Matthias there on the straights. But let's remember here that Matthias driving a Team McLaren car, they had the best specifications of the DFE engine, so he's not short of power.
One must also not forget that the way you set up your car is very important here in regards to aerodynamics. It's probable that François Remen, knowing that his Ferrari has enough power to spare, has been angling his rear wing much more so that he has the needed grip on that twisty section and is indeed giving up some top speed at the long straights.
Meanwhile, we didn't catch that, but Raoul Chareb is another confirmed retirement with the Brabham. Well, I guess the Brabhams cannot count anymore with that strange device they used in the last race. So, unfortunately for them, they're struggling once more.
Well, not that it helped them very much in the last race. They had the sheer bad luck, the share of bad luck. In this case, we also see the remaining Brabham, that's Jason White, is fighting it out with David Sauber. Who seems to have overtaken him some laps ago.
Indeed, we just saw that. It seemed that Pascal Lapive is stopped on the track. It stopped. Something happened there. I don't know. But he's just stopped there on the sand trap.
Oh, maybe
a blown engine, maybe something of the sort. It's very strange. We will see how that fares if he gets going again, but at the moment he's just there. Now meanwhile, Pansarremen, he went off course and he lost quite a lot of ground to Matthias Weber now. But meanwhile, behind him, Martin Lassina is under pressure from Mick Chapman. Martin Lassina, who now is driving the ensign that Yves Passe was driving before, they're now overtaking Matt Goetz, who gets right out of their way. Oops, Mick was stuck there for a bit behind him, but he will overtake him here.
Mick Chapman, meanwhile, of course. It seems that Gerard Rion and Dana Schurer are back at it. It seems that Gerard has been able to catch Dana and overtake her. But Dana is certainly not giving up the position so easily.
Oh, it seems so. Maybe Gerard, in his Gerard style, was cooling himself off and saving himself for the middle of the race. And he seems to be doing just that, because if you see, Jan Kowalski is not very far in front of these two. So
yes, Gerard is the kind of guy whose races are always in a progression. He always goes from less to more, as he somehow warms up and gets into the groove of the race. That's for sure. He is a best finisher than he is a starter.
It seems to be a trend with him indeed. Now they're going down a long Mistral straight now, and Dana Schurer is right behind him, and she will make a move here to try to get the position back. She's alongside Gerard now. And I guess there's not much he can do, although he's trying to hold on, but she cuts in front of him and takes the corner, so she's back to fourth position, and Gerard is down to fifth again. But I don't think Gerard will just stay there. He seems to be, he seems to have a bit more grip, which is normal. He's driving the 79 version of the Lotus and the Works team, no less. So he's probably seizing up to her again to make yet another move while they pass again for Pascal there, who is stopped down on the side of the track. Meanwhile, Jan Kowalski had a little time to breathe here. These two were getting very close to him, but with their fight, he was able to pull a little bit of a gap once again. And he's holding third place for now.
And Yves Placé, meanwhile, seems to have been able to overtake Philippe Martinelli again.
So those two. Maybe Philippe made a mistake, and he's once again profited from it. So I guess we will see it all over again. Philippe Martinelli will try to get close to Yves Passe once again and overtake him.
And again, Yves was able to put another lapped car in between and get some breathe.
Yes, this time the ATS of Emmanuel Haas. Emmanuel Haas here driving the ATS today.
Yeah, there you see it. Yves is really an old fox. He is very good at that kind of maneuvers, at timing it precisely.
Yes, so he's once again in front of Philippe down a long straight. But we know that Philippe Martinelli is very fast on that very quick right-hander right before the straight. So I wouldn't be surprised if he would be right back to Yves' rear, basically, after a few of these corners.
Meanwhile, Dana Schurer is making some way. She's overtaking Mark Florkin. And now it's Gerard Rion's turn. And he's again putting a lot of pressure on her. But Dana is certainly not the driver to bow on pressure. as you can see in the USAC series, he's a really regular driver. He won't make any stupid things, and we'll always be trying to make the most of the points possible in the race.
Well, she's certainly getting the most out of that Rabac Lotus, but Girard, you know, if he wants to keep his championship hopes alive, he has to move a bit up the order, so he will have to overtake her.
Requesen is meanwhile in the lead, driving very constant laps, almost with a clock in his hand, because there are not big differences there, maybe at most caused by lapped cars, but otherwise he's putting his big rhythm again. And when he starts in taking that rhythm, it's almost impossible to follow him.
It has proven to be that way, indeed. I guess, once again, we could expect that he might run into tire troubles, but I don't think he will, judging from past performances. This track might be a bit hard on tires, but we shall see how that evolves during the race. Who has suffered from tires recently was actually Gerard Rion. Last race he lost quite a few places at the end because he just ran out of tires.
At the moment, he seems to have some problems overtaking Dana. He has been able to follow her quickly. But then again, I said many times, he's a calculating driver. So if the rhythm that Dana has seems good to him, if he feels that he couldn't really be quicker if he was in front, then for sure he will let her lead and will be happily following her on a steady rhythm, waiting for a better opportunity to overtake when possible.
Yes, they're now overtaking Miroslav Lavic in the very orange Certis. Miroslav letting him go on the straight. And Gerard, there's no part of the track where he can gain a lot to Dana. So
he's quicker in the Mistra straight. Like you said, probably the factory cause for engine being there where it's most noticeable. But in the rest, he seems to have problems following close to another car. Maybe he's running with a little wing, just relying on the ground effects in that twisty section and trying to that way be quicker in the straight.
It is possible, yes, but one thing is for sure, he doesn't seem to lose any time to Dana. Also, he's always right up there, and they are both slowly gaining time to Jan Kowalski. As they complete another lap here, Gerard following Dana like a mirror, or like a shadow, and his car is noticeably better in that fast section. Ooh, and Gerard now looks on the inside, but there's just no space there. But that part there of the track seems to be the best one for him. He closed right up to Dana there. But now he doesn't seem to be able to stay with her here on these very slow turns there, to be able to just come out of that last one right up to her tail. But he's very close now, and he's already trying to look. She was covering the inside, but I think Gerard's car is faster down the straight, and he's through.
Well, I can tell you, Dana has a good engineering background, and she knows how to set up a car very well. So it's not surprising that the Lotus 78 is shining compared with the 79. She can't just drive fast, she can also set up the car very well, get the best compromise of it. Meanwhile, I should also report that Yves Placet has been able to overtake Peter Labak. He is now in 8th place, while Peter is in 9th place. And Peter is under the threat from Philippe Martinelli, who was, of course, very close behind Yves Placet and is now trying to make his way past Peter.
Indeed. Like I said, we don't have enough cameras to cover all the action here today.
And that's because Dana seems to have overtaken Gerard again.
Oh, you see, we just need to blink. We just need to blink and we lose something. So let's get back to those two again. So Dana Schurer is once again back to fourth place and Gerard is demoted once again to fifth place. Meanwhile, Jan Kowalski, he seems to be able to keep the distance. I don't know if it was a mistake from Gerard, but Gerard was much closer to him after he overtook Dana, but suddenly he's again just a little bit ahead. Ooh, Dana Schurer there went a bit too wide. And he got, she got her wheels on the dirty stuff there. But Gerard was forced to brake and he lost quite a bit of time now. So who's profiting from all this is Jan Kowalski, who seems to be just pulling a little bit away once again.
Yes, he has opened a bit of a gap, 3 seconds now. And it's Petr Lavak who is catching Yves Placet again. Yes, about to overtake him.
Petr Lavak, I think he's been moving up the order. He's very close to the Ligier now. And he will probably try something here. He doesn't seem
again,
to have the
he's
power.
He's finding the power barrier, as we should call it, here in the Mistra Strait. Those V12 are really hard cars to overtake here.
Yes, yeah, you won't find overtaking Yves any easier than Philippe Martinelli did. But Petr Lavak following Yves there like a shadow around these long corners here. He's Williams working very well there. Ooh, he's trying to look there on the outside, but I guess there's no room there. He's trying to make a different line to Yves to find a space, maybe. We almost found one there, but Yves shut the door. And he's still in front of Petr as they complete another lap. And it's down the front straight here.
And I'm looking forward to reading Yves' report of this race, because I suspect that he's enjoying a lot his Ligier, because he's a driver who is a specialist when it comes to driving heavy, powerful cars.
He found space there under acceleration. And he was able to get in front of Yves Placet. That was a very nice maneuver from him. And indeed, he pulled it off, and now he's in front. He was proving to be a bit faster in the twisted bits, so he might get enough space between him and Yves before they get to the front straight there. We shall see.
Well, he certainly needs it, because he knows how fast that Ligier is on the big straight. Anyway, as I was saying, Yves is a guy who is very good at driving those heavy, powerful cars. He was the winner, the champion of the Trans-Am Series last year, driving also right now in the IROC Race of Champions, and he really enjoys that kind of car. Look at that. Oh, that was close.
Yes, Petr weaving all over the track to try to break the toe from Yves. But still, Yves was able to just get right back to him. Maybe weaving there a bit too much, but it's, well, nothing against the rules there. So Yves will now have quite a bit of trouble following him. Ooh, but he made a slight mistake there. He almost went off course. Like I was saying, Yves will have a bit of trouble keeping the distance to him here. So he might have enough space when they get to the front straight to be clear of Yves.
We can maybe switch to Gerard Rion and Dana Schurer. Are again very close together.
Indeed they are. Gerard once again putting Dana under pressure. The fight for fourth place continues. I guess Gerard has, of course, the added, let's just say, motivation of wanting to be the best Lotus on the track. And he's very close to Dana here on the front straight once again. Dana going to the inside, Gerard on the outside. And Gerard is through already. The Lotus 79 very fast down that straight, and he's now covering his grounds. They're both coming to Matt Geddes here. Ooh, and Matt, poor Matt, he spun, trying to get away from the two Lotuses there. Matt is doing the extra mile here today to get, to give room to everybody and don't stand in anybody's way. But it's always nice to see fresh faces here, and we hope he is enjoying this race, which probably isn't easy when driving the Merzario, but I'm also curious to see what he has to say in the end.
Meanwhile, speaking of new faces around, we have here in the chat with us Jason White, who seems to have had troubles with the program again. So what happened, Jason?
Well, I was having a really good race with David Saber, back and forth, and it was a lot of fun. But then he...
You said fun? Fun or fun?
No, fun. F-U-N.
Oh, F-U-N. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah. and then we got to the end of Ferrari, and it was... I think he was making way for the leaders, and he spun out, and I was basically on course to hit him. And I had to choose very quickly which direction to go, and I chose to the left because I figured he'd be rejoining to the right, and I didn't have enough room, and I hit the wall. So I was trying to avoid hitting him. So hopefully he can continue. And but it was, I'm not really displeased anyway, because it was a fun drive, and the car is a dog anyway on this track. it's fast.
At least you had the hero's death, which is not bad.
Yeah.
Maybe missing that fan that you had last race?
Yeah, that fan was helping a lot. I mean, the car has absolutely no grip in slow corners. It's just, you try to put the power down and you can't. The car just wants to slip out from underneath you. So, one thing I'd like to point out while I'm on the TV is that immediately following this race, we will be posting threads for the Indianapolis 500 time trials and the IROC series, both. And those servers will both be going up. So those of you who are interested in driving in the 500, cars will be available for selection immediately following this race.
Well, thanks for the heads up there. So if anyone wants to have a ride in the Indy 500 and don't have a ride currently, you better pay attention to the forum now.
Yes, that's going to be immediately after, and the track will be opening as well. So, and then of course the International Race of Champions, Ben, our director, will be starting on the pole in that race next week. So,
so that will be interesting too. We will see mm-hmm. how Ben fares out there against the best of the best that we have here in HSO.
Well, it's Riverside, so Ben has been good there in the past, so I wouldn't put it past him that he'd do good.
That will be very, very interesting to follow. In fact, we'll have the broadcast of that here next week, so be sure to don't miss that.
Mm-hmm. I'll let you guys get back to the action. Have fun, okay?
Thank you, Jason. We will
Thanks,
talk
Jason.
To you again
Better
later.
Like next time.
All right, take care.
User disconnected from your channel.
So, if you've heard, we're heading for a very, very interesting month of May. As usual here at HSO, we will be having our Indianapolis 500, and this time also a race of champions. So we could say that this is going to be a full May of champions, because Indianapolis has traditionally been always considered a championship or a race in itself. It was part of the USAC series, but also it's a race organized by the own Indianapolis Motor Speedway. That was counted as an individual race elsewhere. It was even run under different rules, the ones that the host Indianapolis Motor Speedway established. So it counted always as a special event, which also gave points to the regular USAC series. So to a certain extent, two races of champions we will be having here this month of May.
Indeed, And well, if I can say so myself, you know, those that have been driving also in our DRM series, watch out for maybe news of that later also. Meanwhile, at the track, Gerard Brion was able to just pull a little bit away from Dana, but now we are seeing that Jan Tietz is getting very, very close to Ray Riddell here. Jan has been gaining ground on gain progressively as this race goes on, and we are now past half point in the race. And Jan is now preparing to attack Ray, who is sitting in sixth position, is the last points position, as we know. So this might be an important fight here.
And not the only one, because Philippe Martinelli is again on Yves Blasé's toes.
Ooh, once again. Yes, Philippe Martinelli, he was bound to recover that time. Oh, and it didn't took time. It didn't took much time for Jan Tietz to pass Ray. He just overtook Ray down the long Mistral straight, and he's now in sixth position, demoting Ray Riddell to seventh.
So out of the points, it was the last point position, but of course Ray will want to fight back. Only he's not the kind of aggressive driver. He is very cool-minded. So if Jan was coming very quickly on a hike and really with a rhythm, I don't think that Rai would voluntarily pose a lot of opposition. That's not his style. His style is much more what he's doing now. He lets Jan pass and then lets Jan lose momentum and be less confident, and will be then trying to be there right behind, putting pressure on him.
Well, he is doing that right now. Jan Tietz couldn't get away from him, and Ray was very, very close to his back there as they moved on to the front straight.
Many fights on the track today.
Meanwhile, we didn't see it, but Jan Kowalski probably made a mistake, because he lost third position and he's now down to fifth place. So he lost two places to both Gerard Rion and Dan Assurer. So the Tyrrell slipped to fifth, while the two Lotus went up a place, and Gerard Rion is now in the podium position.
One of the three spots are more contended on a race. The winner, the last one on the podium, and the last one on the points. Those are the three positions you will always see the people fighting more over.
Meanwhile, a few words for the rest of this grid. Still running. We haven't heard much of him today. Jonathan Nasser-Clint is in 14th with the McLaren. François Hamann is also still running. In 16th, despite earlier troubles from him getting off course. David Savard, the one who modeled most of this mod, is still running.
Just
with
coming
ATS.
With Emmanuel Haas on the other ATS. The ATS owner would not be very happy with what his drivers are doing on the track today.
I guess not, indeed. It's not like they are both very much up the order, but still, I guess the ATS team wants a finish here, and, well, they're being a bit aggressive. In fact, David Sabre is now going to be lapped by Gerard Rion and Dan Assurer. We are very close to each other once again.
There is a saying in motorsports that the only thing worse than hitting another car is hitting your teammate's car.
For sure, you don't want to see that in your CV. Or your resume, as the Americans say. So now, David Sauer, who is occupying 20th position there, he's in front of Matt Geddes. Like we said earlier, the new face here with the Merzario. And he's not doing bad for himself, he's still in this race.
No, he's certainly being a good newcomer, that he is playing it safe. He's doing a quiet job with his Merzario, being quite steady there and not getting into trouble.
The other two that are running front to back are the two Surtees boys, Michał Janak and Miroslav Lavik, are 17th and 18th at the moment, with those two orange Surtees cars. And meanwhile, let's go back to Yves Placé, because Philippe Martinelli is once again right up his back. So it's Yves Placé versus Philippe Martinelli once again. Philippe looking around Yves to try to overtake him.
Many interesting battles today, because Ralf Riddle is still also putting a lot of pressure on Jan Tietz. We have in the next two places Yves against Philippe Martinelli. Gerard Rion and Dan Assurer are still quite close together. So, lots of action on the track today. a pity not being able to cover it all that easily.
Well, it's like that in real motor racing, so the simulation is there also in that too. Yves still in front of Philippe Martinelli. He managed to stay in front in that fast section of the track. So now it won't be easy to Philippe to find a way here, and it won't be easy for sure to find a way down the long Mistral Strait.
The interest of this battle, as we have said it many times, is the very different characteristics of the cars. Also in the hands of two very great drivers. Even so, we should also mention, because we know we can do it, that Philippe Martinelli he has a special ability there because he's driving with a very, very personal wheel. He's driving not as you would expect with pedals, but everything he's controlling it with his wheel. He has a custom steering wheel where the accelerator and the brake are in pads, so he's changing his gears with buttons on the wheel, and he's doing accelerating and braking with pedals that have only about 3 centimeters of travel. So he's really a virtuoso, more or less like a pianist. He's doing everything with all his fingers at the same time. It's a great display of coordination there for Philippe.
Well, that surely sounds impressive. We happen to know that Philippe is also an avid slot car enthusiast. So I guess in a way he's, used to accelerating with his fingers. I mean, we all played with slot cars as kids, at least the older of us. But it's still very impressive performances from Philippe Martinelli, especially that he can be so consistent while managing everything with his hands, a bit like Alex Zanardi in real life.
Well, yes, indeed. That's an accurate driver that learned to drive exclusively with his hands and showed that he had not lost his touch when it came to motor racing.
It's curious to notice that Ray Vidal is still very, very close to Jan Tietz. So despite Jan Tietz overtaking him, I guess Ray Vidal stepped up his pace, and they are now overtaking slow traffic. But Ray Vidal is dispatching everything and everyone in a timely manner, and he's now actually attacking Jan Tietz.
Yes, like I said, he's a very calculating driver, so if he feels that Jan Tietz could bring him quicker forward, he will have no problem letting him pass or not making a first opposition, and then staying on Jan Tietz's tail so that he's able to be even quicker than he was before. Probably part of it is that the Copper Sucker doesn't have a powerful Cosworth engine. So maybe if he feels that he could benefit from the tow on the long straight, he will be combining his forces with Jan Tietz there. As you can see, he's completely unable to overtake on the long straights, but it maybe is giving him a bit of a tow there. So if he feels that he is improving his lap times like that, that is in a good position towards the end of the race because he's making a distance with the cars that are following, then he won't hesitate to play that game and follow Jan.
Indeed, what surprises me is how good he is around the corners, because we would expect that Jan Tietz with his ground effects would just get away from Ray Vidal, but Ray is using that Cooper Sucker to the maximum, and it just seems that Jan can't get away from him. He's now trying to break the toe.
It could be also the explanation of his poor straight line speed. Because you see that he's really struggling in that Mistral straight. So he's probably also driving with a bigger wing angle so that he has that grip. And as long as he doesn't lose touch with the car in front in the straights, he is of course able to keep it rather well behind in the twisty sections.
Yes, I mean, it's quite ironic, because Jan Tietz, he recovered all the ground to Ray, he overtook Ray, and he probably maybe thought to himself, oh, so now this is done, and I'll move on, make it to the next driver on the track, but actually he finds himself under pressure from Ray now.
Yeah, he's the only one who is suffering some pressure
Emmanuel
now, because
Haas.
The other fights on the track seem to have somehow made a bit of a crash right now, the truce, because Gerard Rion has opened a bit of a distance with Dana Schurer. And Yves Placet has still Philippe right behind him. Not
yes,
maybe as insisting or as aggressive, but still there.
They run around Emmanuel Haas. Emmanuel, who is now to be a regular here in this championship, isn't he? And once again, he's keeping it on the track and being consistent. He showed that he could be consistent right in his first race when he actually got into the points. So it's good to see him around here also. And Meridal once again following Jan Tietz very closely, and Jan Tietz once again weaving around, trying to break the toe. So they inching forward and getting close to Jan there. I would think that Ray knows how to set up that Cooper Sucker very, very well, because just look at this. You know, he's actually attacking Jan there on this long corner where we would expect the Wolf with its ground effects to just pull away.
And I can tell you, Jan is not a slow driver, so it's not a problem of the driver being unable to extract the most of the car. Jan is a very quick driver, so, well, certainly Ray is playing his cards very well there.
Indeed he is. He, who pointed already in several occasions with the Cooper Sucker, wants to do it again today. Ooh, he's now very close to Tietz, because Jan made a mistake there. Ray may try something here, but that Cooper Sucker is not very fast in a straight line, so he has no room to try to do something.
But that's certainly a desperating situation for any driver, because if you feel that you are somehow a bit quicker, but then you go to the straights, and you find yourself completely unable to even come out of the slipstream, then it's certainly frustrating. Your main hopes are trying to force the other driver into an error, and that's maybe not going to be an easy task with a driver of the quality of Jan.
It won't be indeed. They're coming once again to the missile straight, and now it seems to me that Ray is a bit closer. Let's see if he can do something now. He's getting closer once again in the draft, or on the slipstream. Jan Tietz is already weaving around the track, trying to break the toe. Ooh, Ray's very close now. He's pulling alongside, but he doesn't have the power to do anything, and he has to stay behind once again. Ooh, he went a bit off course there, but he's getting really close to Jan Tietz there on this corner. But there's no room there.
That's what his highest hopes are.
I believe so too.
The problem for Rai is probably that even if he manages to overtake Jan, it seems to me that Jan will be able to recover the position easily later on the straight.
Well, that's how he overtook Ray in the first place. It was down the straight where Ray could do nothing about it. So indeed, if Ray wants to find a way through, he better have some space where he can just pull away a gap, or else Jan Tietz will just go back right through him again.
At this point, probably Ray's best option is to continue putting some pressure on Jan, but not overly much, so that at some point Jan relaxes and somehow loses focus of his rhythm, so that maybe that brings him to make some kind of, if not a complete mistake, something that is enough for Rai to be able to make a surprise move.
Another fight now is Matthias Weber versus David Jakes. They are both very, very close to each other. They are 11th and 12th at the moment. And Matthias is trying to find a way past David there. They both seem to struggle to put the power down a lot. I believe that the Paul Ricard circuit is a circuit that potentiates these kinds of duels. The nature of the track allows people to get very close to each other. And, ooh, David made a mistake there. Through. Matthias Weber is through. Now he's 11th and David is down to 12.
You're very probably right about that, because having two such very distinct sections in the track, it forces the cars to act a bit like a rubber band. The quicker cars, the cars that have more power, will catch up with the slower ones in this part and the slower ones with the others in the other part of the track. So instead of keeping steady gaps between them, which would of course preclude the many fights, it does, as you did, potentiate it, because it helps the cars coming together at some points of the track.
So let's go to Yves Placet once again, because Philippe Martinelli is back again very close to him. And he might want to try to make a move soon. Although I would imagine that as the fuel of the Ligier is burned out, the Ligier is getting better and better to drive for Yves. So he's able to maintain his rhythm and his positions better and better as this race goes on.
Yeah, that's for sure. Because the big fuel load of the Ligier at the beginning of the race, as it goes, as the race goes on and the fuel is getting used, the difference is each time smaller with the other cars. Philippe was trying it there, but unable at this time.
He doesn't
this
seem to have the power.
This is going to be a very fun race for the Ibs, I tell you. Looking forward to see his report.
They're going
He's certainly enjoying it much more than the other car. And look at that
lap
again.
Down.
He again put a car in the middle between them.
Yes, in this case, Emmanuel Haas. He opens up to Philippe Martinelli now. And this is a duel of Frenchmen here, promising to last the whole race. Of course, Yves always avoiding making any mistakes, especially in this section here, because that would certainly cost him the place. So he keeps...
Certainly very hard to do, because he can't go too slow there, but at the same time he can make a mistake.
Indeed, and completes yet another lap. And yet again, Yves goes to another lap in front of Philippe here. Meanwhile, Jan Tits and Ray Vidal are close, nose to tail, still. That promises to last the whole race also, because we all know how strong Ray Vidal is at the end of races.
That's also going to be very telling mentally for them. Just doing a whole race, a Formula One race, with that kind of pressure, well, that's certainly not something that anyone would do easily.
Yeah, that's for sure. Although now who is under pressure is Jan Tits, and maybe this is all playing into Ray Vidal's tactic. I mean, I would assume he wouldn't have the pace to go with Jan normally, but by just being behind and trying to wear Jan off, he might force Jan to wear his tires or wear himself mentally and make him make a mistake that will just give the position to Ray and put him in a more comfortable position to keep that last points position standing.
Yeah, we can't forget that they are both fighting for that very important points position. It's the last one, the last point position. So it's the difference between being at the table or not being there. And meanwhile, Philippe Martinelli is again doing everything he can to put pressure on Yves.
Yes, Philippe Martinelli once again.
Coming out to the twisty section.
He's once again very close. But Yves making that Ligier
sideways completely.
Yes, he's making that Ligier very wide around this track.
He's throwing it around. Oh! Throwing it around as if it were some kind of drift car. That's
well,
a true mastery there.
I would imagine that his tires won't be in a fine shape at the end of this race, but that's fine if he can hold on the position. That will prove to be hard against the determined Philippe Martinelli there.
Look here at the end of the Mistra Strait, what happens? Yves has gained some 20 or 30 meters, and they are almost all of them out as soon as they come to the second corner. They're gone.
Yes, the difference there in behavior is obvious. Ooh, and Philippe, they're almost gaining a bit
took
of
a very
space
late
and not
apex.
Quite.
Philippe saw it coming. That was a great opportunity for Philippe. It was a bit of a desperate move from Yves there, going for that very late apex.
I guess it's the only way for Yves to keep in front of Philippe Martinelli. He's trying to use all the track he can. But Philippe will try to get into one of those gaps that Yves is leaving open. Or leaving open, I should say. Meanwhile, we have another confirmed retirement. François Hémen has retired with the Ferrari. That's a shame. Although we have still 21 cars in this race, which is surprising now that we are one third of this race to the end only. Forty-two laps completed, 54. Ooh, and Heaps is indeed trying to hold on to that ninth place at the moment. And Philippe is very, very close now.
Yeah, this time he came to the Mistra straight much closer, but still it's not enough with the power of that B12.
Yes, it doesn't seem to matter how close he is, because Yves doesn't even need to weave or something to break the... Ooh, now there's
a
chance.
Yeah, but that's the difference now, that being so close at the beginning of this section means that they can, when he enters the turns, those quick turns, he can really be even closer to try a movement.
There was a chance there, but Yves shut the door, and he's now taking defensive action. Making tighter lines so that Philippe can't have any room to overtake there. Ooh, Philippe looking there, looking. He almost touched there, if not even touched. He sure locked his wheel to avoid Yves Placé's rear.
And
the
we
fight
should
goes
have
on.
One of those picture-in-picture features, because the fight between Jan Tietz and Rai Riddle is really noteworthy also. Rai is putting real big pressure on Jan Tietz right now.
Yes, the difference between the two is literally nothing at this point, less than a tenth. And now Rai Riddle once again down the front straight, the Mistral straight, trying to use the toe of Jan Tietz, who is weaving around.
And because, as we say in Spain, there is not a two without a three, it seems that also Dan Ashour has been able to catch back up with Gerard Briones, putting pressure on him. So this seems, this is being a very fun race, and there seem to be fights all over the place.
Indeed, we are not short of action here today, that's for sure. Dan Ashour and Gerard Briones fight is for third place. Jan Tietz and Rai Riddle fight is for the last points place, the sixth. And indeed, Jan Tietz is really, really under pressure now. In the twisty section, Rai Riddle seems to be quite a lot faster. And he's making this last part of the race hell, literally, for Jan Tietz here.
Well, Rai certainly knows how to put pressure on someone.
He certainly does, and look at that, he's doing that at this very moment. He's really, really close to Jan in that fast section. And as they approach Mark Florken once again, Jan there locking his wheels, and they both went over Mark very, very quickly. Mark opened the door as much as he could there.
Yeah, he did a nice maneuver this time. But I think he's going very slowly now. Okay.
Maybe he was just recovering from the scare there of seeing him to blast through him. Once again down the front straight, once again Jan Tietz weaving back and forth. did not give any chance of Ray to catch him, although I think it would always be hard for Ray Riddle to overtake him down the straight. I think if Ray is going to make an overtaking move, we'll be in the more twisty sections.
Yes, there is especially one point entering one of those fast turns where Ray is clearly lifting because he would otherwise hit Jan. That's probably the place where the difference between the two of them is the most.
Yes, like especially here, look at that. Jan Tietz sitting there on the outside of the corner and Ray was looking on the inside, but there was no space there. Jan Tietz seems to be suffering from quite a bit of understeer, I would say, in this section of the track. But he seems to have the straight line speed to stay in front of Ray. I would imagine that Ray Riddle has a setup with quite a lot of wing there, quite a lot of downforce. And he's using it to the most, so he can keep up here with Jan. I guess Ray Riddle is making Emerson Fittipaldi proud.
Certainly. Emerson was again also a very calculating driver.
Oh, and I have very bad news to report. I'm sorry to interrupt you, but Philip Martinelli has lost both wings and the wheel. So I guess that's the end of his race. We don't know what happened, but he was just lapped by Greg Clasin, our leader, and now they're stuck, and that's the end of his race.
I'm watching the replay now, and it seems that what happens is that he made a bit of an error on the braking, trying to enter the turn, overtaking Yves. They were on parallel, and he locked the wheels, and he went straight out. He seems he lost the front wing, and then having no grip, he locked the front wheels and went out straight.
Well, he was trying desperately to overtake Yves, and I guess Yves won the nerves battle there, and he's now with his ninth place more or less secured. Who is not secured is Jan Tietz, who is still under big pressure from Ray there. So our top six is still at the moment Grégoire Voisin, who leads with almost 40 seconds of an advantage over his teammate Vincent Peretta. Third, we have Gérard Drouin, following very closely by Danny Schurer. Fifth, we have Jan Kowalski. And sixth, we have Ray Riddle here, because Jan Tietz has just, well, let's just say that he's probably out of this race too, because he just lost his left front wheel, his front wing, and that's the end of his race. No, I couldn't see what happened
probably
there.
Probably again also someone who didn't cope well with the pressure.
They were overtaking some backmarkers, so I don't know what happened there. That might have had some influence. But anyways, it's the end of Jan Tietz's race. And Ray Riddle won this particular battle by putting Jan Tietz under the most pressure that he probably felt for a while.
So let's see what happens now with the other remaining big battle, because Dana Schurer is again closing to Gérard Drouin.
Yes, I guess Ray Riddle has 5 seconds of an advantage over Petr Lavak for sixth place. I don't know if that's enough, but for now at least his place is safe. Indeed, Dana Schurer, she was overtaken by Gerard in that occasion that we were watching. and Gerard is in front of her since then, but he doesn't seem to be able to pull a big gap here. This is a fight for third position. I would assume that they are both now seeing if any of the if the other still has any tires left for the end of this race. That might prove decisive here. So our top six now is Grégoire Glassin, Vincent Perretta, Gérard Rion, Dan Assurer, Jan Kowalski, and Ray Vidal. Then we have Petr Lavak, Yves Placé, David Jax, and Matthias Weber in 10th. And then outside the top 10, we have still Jonathan Nusserklint, Martin Lasina, Michał Janak, Mick Chapman, Miroslav Lavik, Emmanuel Haas, and David Saber. And following in the last two positions, Matt Geddes and Mark Florin. Gerard Rion once again cruising around in another lap. Danis, she shadows Gerard and has been shadowing him for much of this race now, but she doesn't seem to be quite able to catch, to make that last little bit of space to get to the back of Gerard. Now, I don't know if she's trying to conserve her tires or if she's just unable to catch Gerard at this point. But whatever it is, Gerard is still in third. And by being third, he's trying to keep his championship hopes alive, because if Greg wins, he will once again extend his lead. And Gerard can only do so much to keep the championship fight for him alive. And at the moment, that is keeping his third place and hoping that Dana cannot overtake him and get those 4 points. It's interesting to see that Gerard seems to be able to make the most of the gap to Dana down the long straight, while Dana seems to be able to just get a little bit closer to Gerard in the last twisty section before the front finish line. I guess maybe setup options play a role there. And meanwhile, I would say that Petr Lavak is slowly catching up Ray Vidal. We will see how fast he can do it, because we might have yet again a battle for the last points position before this race ends. Oh, and big drama here. Gerard has just crashed. He crashed and he lost his rear wing. And that will prove to be a handful. Oh, and this was not good for both of them. I guess Gerard Rion just had an off spin, and Dan Assurer had nowhere to go and just hit Gerard now. So Gerard was doing everything to keep in front of her. He made a mistake, and now he paid the price dearly, because he will have to stop, and he's already outside the point. This is a disaster for him, because he won't get any points in this race now.
And Dana has damage also. She has lost the front wing.
Yes, Dana lost the front wing too. That's why I said it was a big drama for both. So she's going for the pits as well. Her task a bit easier than Gerard, who without his rear wing is spinning around, and maybe he will retire. I will see. Dana is going for the pits for sure. Well, at least,
No.
She decides to continue. Maybe she thinks she has enough of a gap to go to the end of this race.
Well, there's only five laps to the end, so it's probable that she thinks that she will, even if she loses many positions there, there would be many more lost if she would be staying in the pits for repairs.
That's, That's probable. Now Jan Kowalski overtakes her, and he's back in third position, as he
but
was in the beginning of this race.
But that's 20 seconds to Peter Laback, and he did the last but, lap in 1:51, and Peter Laback is
But Peter Laback is going nowhere, because we have big drama here. At the end of this race, Peter Laback has lost his front wing, and I think he has suspension damage, while Ray Riddle is in the pit, probably for some damage as well. So something happened between these two. I know that Peter Laback was catching Ray Riddle, but something must have happened, because both of them have damage at this point, which promotes Yves Placet to sixth now with the Ligier.
Maybe they caught debris.
Maybe.
On the track from an earlier accident.
Meanwhile, Dan Assurer doesn't seem to want to let Jan Kowalski go, because they're trading places. Now Jan Kowalski is back in front of her, but she sure seems to have enough grip to get to the end of this race.
Yes, the car being a ground effects one, and a very accentuated one. We all know the Lotus had the wings mainly for trimming, so it could be very well possible that it can still work to a decent extent without one of the wings.
Indeed, Jan Kowalski now getting a bit of room between him and Dana. So the top six now at this moment is Gregor Wasson leading, Vincent Perret is second, Jan Kowalski is third, Dana Schur is in fourth, Peter Laback is fifth, but he's also without the front wing. Yves Placet is in sixth, and following these two are Matthias Weber and Jonathan Asserklint. So the two McLarens going up the order here now at the end of this race. Riddle is.
It seems to be that Peter is again taking the same option as Dana, that he knows that there are only five laps till the end. In fact, one even less, because Greg Wasen just lapped him. No, but in the end, he has had to enter the pits. Peter Laback is finally into the pits. I think he had a puncture or something like that, because one of his wheels was smoking badly, so probably suspension bent or something like that.
So Peter Laback is in the pits, and this will soon promote Matthias Weber to sixth, the last points position, and already promoted Yves Placet to fifth. So all kinds of drama happening here at the end of this race, when we have less than four laps remaining. Yves Placet is now fifth. Dana Schurer is fourth. She has quite a bit of a big of an advantage over Yves. I guess even without the front wing, she will be able to keep the fourth place up until the end.
She's doing 1:50s at the moment, while Yves Placet is doing in his last lap, he did 1:47. So that's about 3 seconds gap per lap. And the remaining laps should certainly, in principle, not be enough to make up for that difference.
It seems not. And now that Peter Laback is standing in the pits, the top 10 changes once again. Gregor Wasen is leading, Vincent Perret is second, Jan Kowalski is third, Dana Schur is still fourth, Yves Placet is fifth, Matthias Weber is sixth now, Jonathan Asserklint, his teammate, is seventh, David Jacques is promoted to eighth, and Peter Laback is still standing in ninth, because Martin Lassina will now overtake him. Yes, Martin Lassina now overtakes Peter Laback, so Martin is ninth, and Peter Laback is now tenth. Behind him is now Ray Riddle, who himself stopped for damage. And it seems that Peter will maintain the tenth position for now.
Yes, he's come out of the pits just in time, in front of Peter. So he seems to be still in the top 10.
When I say that Jonathan Asserklint is Matthias Weber's teammate, that's not correct. They are both driving McLarens, and they are both having a big fight now. So let's go to that. Matthias Weber is fighting Jonathan Asserklint, both in McLaren's M26, although for different teams, and they're fighting for the last points position at the moment.
Yeah, this is a big boost for Jonathan, who has been doing some very steady races, has had his fair share of bad luck in others, but he's doing now his best to get that elusive point. And I think that would be a worthy reward for his efforts this season.
Indeed, I wouldn't be... Ooh, he's trying now. He's going on the inside there. but not enough space. I wouldn't be surprised if Jonathan followed his usual plan and saved a lot of tires for the end. So now he can attack with anything and everything. Matthias there. Once again, they're coming to lap Matt Geddes, who once again gets out of the way immediately. And Jonathan is really putting Matthias under pressure here. I guess it's a matter of honor, not only to get the last points position, but to beat the best McLaren here. And Jonathan is doing, they both are doing a good job. I guess Jonathan came from behind, but he will soon run out of time. So if he wants to do a move, he has to do it fast.
And Jonathan, who is one of the guys here in our league, who has a background in real racing, because he has been racing in, folk race since he was 16, which is a particular discipline that is similar, a bit more informal than rallycross. And he has been having lots of fun with that in real life, like I said.
Well, he's certainly using that experience here. Let's see if he can overtake Matthias before the end of this race. When I think that maybe Gregor Wasin is in his last lap. So if nothing really strange happens, he will win this race yet again. And it will be a big boost for him for the championship. It will be a big boost for the Shadow team for the Constructors' Championship too, because his teammate Vincent Peretta is now... Ooh, and Jonathan is alongside. And he's through Matthias now. Let's see if he can keep the position. And he does. Jonathan is now sixth. He demoted Matthias Weber to seventh, so Jonathan is through, and immediately he gets a little bit of a gap. So indeed, his tires probably are in better shape now at the end of this race.
He went sideways completely at this turn.
Yes, he entered a bit too hot there. Let's see if Matthias can fight back. Oh, he's really, really getting the tail of that McLaren out, Jonathan. And Gregor Wasin has won the race. He won the French Grand Prix. Vincent Peretta will come second. Jan Kowalski will come third. We're waiting for them to cross the line now. Like we predicted, Dan Ashour seems to have enough of a gap. Ooh, Matthias is attacking now. Matthias Weber is attacking Jonathan Nusserklint. And he passed Jonathan once again in the last lap. He passed Jonathan once again. Gerard Rion is getting close to both of them, but Gerard is not a factor here anymore. Ooh, Jonathan is trying there on the inside, but there's no room there. He has to go on the dirt. Matthias is covering all the track here. He's taking the defensive line. He's covering every space. I guess there's nothing Jonathan can do at this point. We will see. Now, for the last few corners, and once again Matthias shutting the door there. Jonathan's trying to line up the car, but the line is too close, and he won't be able to overtake Matthias anymore, but he's trying. Ooh, that was close, but Matthias Weber got that last point after all. A great last lap comeback from Matthias, and it was very close, a very good fight here at the end. And like I said, the standings now were Gregor Wasin, he won. Vincent Peretta was second. Jan Kowalski third. Dan Ashour is now crossing the line for fourth position. Yves Placé is fifth. And Matthias Weber is sixth. This was the point standings here. Jonathan Nusserklint seventh. David Jakes finished the race in eighth. Martin Lassina ninth. And Petr Lavak managed to get the 10th position. Other finishes were Ray Riddall, Michał Janak, Gerard Rion, Mick Chapman. He retired at the end, but he's still classified as 14th. Miroslav Lavik, 15th. David Seber finished the race in 16th in front of his teammate Emmanuel Haas. Matt Geddes in 18th and Mark Forken in 19th. These are all the finishes here today. A lot of cars finishes this race. And it was a very, very exciting race for us here. I hope you enjoyed there at home. And this was very good for Gregor Wasin, very good for the Shadow team. Thank you very much again for being here, Alberto. we didn't hear much of you at the end, but with all the action, it was hard to not look at all that. And thank you very much.
I didn't want to interrupt you. It was such an exciting race at the end. So we hope to see everyone around here for this exciting month of May. We will see us on the track. See you guys.
Thank you very much, Ben, for your directing work here. See you everybody at home. And we will talk again next time. Bye-bye for now.